So, well, okay, we had been discussing about Peshwa's period and how that northern expansion has taken place under the second Peshwa, that is Peshwa Bajirao I, whose period was from 1720 to 1740. In the last class, we have seen that how Peshwa Balaji Vishwanath Bhat, the first Peshwa, he went to Delhi along with some Maratha contingent, and then there was some skirmishes, some fighting, and then he comes back with Sanad. So those Sanads were very important. I mean, the emperor has agreed to give Sanad, and probably the Sanad came later on. But nevertheless, the basic purpose of the Maratha contingent accompanying Sayyid brothers to Delhi was to get that Sanad, which empowered Shahu to collect taxes from the provinces, southern provinces of Mughal Empire. So, you know, when the Maratha contingent went to north along with Sayyid brother, they saw the situation there, they saw the condition. And there was this young gentleman, that is Bajirao, son of first Peshwa Balaji Vishwanath Bhat. And he was accompanying that contingent. And he saw the deteriorating condition in the Mughal Empire, Mughal court. And then later on, he became Peshwa in 1720. We will study those circumstances. But then he, during his trip to Delhi, he understood that, and he made up his mind that if we can channelize the energies of the Maratha in the northern direction, that is the Mughal Empire, which has become considerably weak, that will be a great advantage to the Marathas. And then later on, when he became Peshwa in 1720, that is 1 year after that, he implemented that plan, and we saw that there is a rapid expansion of the Maratha Empire in the northerly direction. And the important battles that contributed to this northerly expedition under Peshwa Bajirao is Battle of Amzira, which was not fought by Bajirao, but it was fought by his brother. But he was the main instrumental guiding force, which was fought in 1729. Battle of Jaipur was fought by Bajirao. Battle of Daboi was also fought by Bajirao, 1731. And then from 1732 to 35, we find that the Maratha Sardar, which were brought forward by Peshwa Bajirao, like Shindes and Holkar, under them there was a rapid expansion of the Maratha Empire in Malwa. And then in 1735, Bajirao, he went to Rajputana. That was one of the important expedition. And then in 1737, in March, he attacks Delhi, you know, the outskirts of Delhi. That was a very bold move on the part of the Marathas, which has really shaken shaken the Mughal Empire. And then the last very important battle that was fought by Bajirao was 1737 October. That is when Nizam was defeated at Bhopal. So these are the important battles. So we see that from 1729 to 1737, that is almost a period of 8 years. During these 8 years, there had been a rapid expansion of the Maratha towards north, and these important battles contributed to this expansion. Now let us go a little bit into the background of Bajirao Peshwa before we start discussing these battles and expeditions in detail. He was born in August 1700, and he was the eldest son of Peshwa Balaji Vishwanath. Balaji Vishwanath was Peshwa from 1713 to 1720, and as I already referred in the introduction, Balaji Vishwanath went to Delhi in 1719, and this young boy, Bajirao, of 19 years only, he also accompanied his father. And as he was a very, very clever observer, he observed the condition of the Mughal Empire, which was deteriorating very fast. He was trained in warfare, Bajirao, and he was known to be very strong as well as handsome. You know, it is recorded that there was a reputation of Bajirao being very handsome, and it is stated that wherever he used to go, the people and the population used to throng to have a look at him. And it is stated that, you know, when he had a meeting with Nizam, the wives of Nizam, they heard about the handsome feature of Bajirao, and they requested Nizam ki, well, we want to see Bajirao Peshwa once. And Bajirao had organized the meeting. You know, the royal Muslim ladies, they always remain in parda, under the veil. But they, you know, all that was arranged, and they were sitting behind parda. And Bajirao was, you know, Nizam requested, and Bajirao went there for a few minutes. And in fact, Nizam's mother was so mesmerized by him that she also called him her own son. So he had that kind of magnifying, magnetic personality. And he was having a capacity to put up with a lot of hard work. You know, he could spend days and nights together on the horseback without any need of rest. And that swift movement of the Marathas had proved them to be very advantageous. In fact, it was one of the important features that had contributed to the rapid victories. And that, of course, we'll be seeing one by one in the different battles, how this rapid movement had proved to be one of the important USP against the heavy artillery of the Mughals, which was no doubt very destructive, very effective, but very difficult to maneuver very swiftly. It needed to be carried with a large number of bullocks and pushed and pull and place, and then only you can do the bombardment. But when you take to the guerrilla tactics and doesn't come on the frontal collision with the enemy, but you just wheel around, attack, and then run away, this big cannon, they become a kind of liability, because you cannot move them very swiftly, and you need a large number of bullocks and manpower to maneuver them well. Now, let us talk about the circumstances during which Bajirao became Peshwa. In 1919, Peshwa Balaji Vishwanath, he comes back with Sanad from Delhi to Satara. He was given very warm welcome, but he did not survive long. In few months after that event, he dies. And as the Chhatrapati Shivaji has made a tradition that the post should not be hereditary, but it should be given according to the capability. And there are a number of people who think that they are capable even if they are not. And that is what happened in the Satara court. There were a number of contenders who wanted to become Peshwa, and they had their own supporter in Shahu's court. You know, now Shahu, the grandson of Chhatrapati Shivaji, he was settled at Satara. Satara became his capital, and which has become a kind of a power center, a main center from where the important decision used to be taken. So there were a number of contenders for Peshwa's post, of course, one of the party in the court was definitely supporter of Bajirao. But there are a number of people who thought and who told the king that Bajirao is too young. He is quite imprudent youth, 20 years, and he will drag the Maratha kingdom into the war, and that will lead to the destruction. So don't give this Peshwaship to Bajirao, but give it to some more matured person who is having an experience. But you know, Shahu, after the initial battles, he did not go to the battlefield, he did not fought a lot many battles, but he was a person who understood the qualities of the person and accordingly gave him the responsibility. And he understood that Bajirao, though very young, he is youthful, have energy, as well as he is equally wise. He is having a wisdom, and it is Bajirao who can really give the leadership to the Maratha Empire, which has started growing now. He convinced opponents who were opposed to Bajirao becoming Peshwa that I will give this Peshwaship to Bajirao as a kind of experiment, and if I find that he is not capable, I will remove him from the post. And there was one more factor, kind of sympathy for Bajirao, is that Balaji Vishwanath, his father, has done great service to Shahu, but he could not enjoy the privilege. You know, he had lived his life through hardship along with Shahu, and as the empire was settling down, as the Sanad came from Delhi, he dies. And then people thought, and Shahu also was convinced, that as the father could not enjoy the kingdom, let his son have the privilege of becoming Peshwa. And with this background, he was made Peshwa in 1720. I have written 1919 here. This should be 1719. Bajirao becomes Peshwa in 1720. Now, what kind of policies the Bajirao had in his mind, that I have already told you, that during his northern expedition along with his father in 1719, he thought that northern area, the area under the control of the Mughal is an area from where the Marathas should expand their kingdom. And when he explained his policy to the court in Satara, there was a lot of opposition to this policy. You know, people they thought that it is better that the Marathas should consolidate their power, consolidate their empire in the southern part of India first. Southern part was the part of it was already conquered during the period of Shivaji, during the period of Rajaram. Rajaram has taken shelter in Jinji, and from Maharashtra to Jinji, there were series of forts. So, you know, the Marathas, they had a significant presence already in south. There were Ghorpades and many more. They thought that let us consolidate our power in south. But Bajirao understood that in south, there is a very one important contender who will put a check on the power of the Maratha, and that is Nizam. Nizam was very capable. He was, as we see now, he had a number of battles and number of diplomatic maneuver with Bajirao. And Bajirao thought that if we remain entangled in the South India, and in any case, in comparison to North, the land in South is not that fertile. It is mountainous, having a small river. And in comparison, Northern India, the plains of Doab, you know, that is the plain between Ganga and Jamuna, this very fertile land. And if you, Marathas can have their control over those areas, they can earn much more revenue than wasting our energy fighting for the land in South India, which is first thing, which is hotly contested by many powers, as well as it won't bring you as much revenue as you can earn in North. And then he justifies his policies of expanding into the southern part, expanding into the northern part. Now, but it took some time. It took some time for the people to get convinced. And initially, Shahu, along with his other courtier, other people in the court, had decided that we should, occupy south first. And with that, with that policy, the Battle of Palkher was fought. As our syllabus is mainly concerned about the northernly expedition of the Marathas, so we'll not be going into the very lot of details in the Battle of Palkher. But the Battle of Palkher is significant because it secured Shahu's position. So we'll be having a little bit of discussion. This Battle of Palkher was fought in 1628, that is 8 years after Peshwa, Bajirao becomes Peshwa. So, you know, a few years he took to consolidate his power gather the people who could support his policies. But this Battle of Palkher was fought. And as Bajirao anticipated, and it was well known that Nizam, apart from Maratha, it was Nizam who was also important contender for the supremacy in Deccan. He was made Subedar of Deccan, and then he became virtually independent after I am again missed of the year here. This is 1728. Nizam, he was a Mughal governor of southern part of Mughal provinces, Deccan. And at the same time, the Marathas, by the Sanad of 1719, were given the right to collect Chauth and Sardeshmukhi. That is the right to collect the tax in return of certain service given to the Mughal court. But Nizam, he always contended that. He was not willing to give that right to Shahu and his supporter like Bajirao Peshwa. And there was one more contender for Shahu's throne, that is Sambhaji of Kolhapur. You know, after Rajaram, the Maratha house remained divided. We have studied this, how Shahu came back from the imprisonment in 1707, and how he has to fight against his own aunt Tarabai in 1707, and he comes out supreme. But you know, he allowed that another house of Shivaji to survive at Kolhapur. He established himself at Satara, and Rajaram's children, that is, first it was Shivaji II who was a child, and the administration was looked after by Tarabai. But then there was a revolution in Kolhapur, and Sambhaji and his mother Rajasbai, the another wife of Rajaram, they came to power. So Sambhaji was ruling at Kolhapur, who was cousin of Shahu. Now, you know, Nizam, he wanted to take an advantage of these two ruling houses of the descendant of Shivaji, and he instigated Sambhaji ki, okay, you join hands with us and you will be the main Chhatrapati of Marathas. Now we will sideline Shahu. And Sambhaji, he was neither diplomatically very sound, nor he was having, you know, nor he had shown any valor on the battlefront. He did not had a very strong army, so he joined hands with Nizam, and they form a kind of coalition. Nizam, Chhatrapati Sambhaji of Kolhapur, and some other Maratha Sardar who were not happy with the rise of Bajirao, and they were not happy with Shahu. They joined hands. As they joined hands, Bajirao made a counter move. He attacks Karnataka, and Nizam, on the other hand, he reaches to Pune along with Sambhaji. Sambhaji, he declares Sambhaji as the real Chhatrapati of the Marathas, and then he started, you know, imposing taxes on the people. But you know, Bajirao, he played a move. He started going towards Aurangabad. That was the capital of Nizam during those days. Later on, the Nizam capital moved to Hyderabad. And this both army, they came face to face at Palkhed. But you know, Bajirao, he always, his swift movement was a very important advantage. He was having a very efficient spy system, and through them he used to get information about the enemy's movement. So there was a river, and Nizam was having heavy artillery. Artillery was effective, but it was very heavy. And when Nizam was crossing river, when half of his army has crossed the river and the gun were to be brought, Bajirao attacks and he traps him in the place where all the supply was cut off. He was not getting any food supply. His artillery guns were away from him, and finally Nizam surrenders, and the Treaty of Mungi Sheogao was signed between Bajirao and Nizam in 1728, 6th March. So this has increased the prestige of Bajirao, and it has made now the position of Shahu secure. Now, you know, he will not, Nizam has agreed that he will not henceforth support Sambhaji of Kolhapur. And though nothing, it was not written, but it is believed by the historian that Nizam now agreed with Nizam and Bajirao, they agreed that Bajirao will channelize the Maratha energy towards north, and the south will be left for Nizam. This is said to be a kind of unwritten agreement, but then it is generally, we see that events that happen after this Battle of Palkhed, that Nizam, initially at least, he did not obstruct the Bajirao's and Maratha progress towards north. And the Marathas, from their part, left Nizam's domain by and large unmolested. They did not trouble Nizam a lot. But later on, as Bajirao's power went on rising, Nizam obviously became jealous. And then there was the battle that was fought at Bhopal, about which we will be discussing later on. So the importance of this battle is that it has increased the prestige of Bajirao first, and it has secured the position of Shahu as an unchallenged Maratha ruler. Well, now let us go to the next, that is Marathas in Malwa, the Battle of Amzera and the defeat of Giridhar Bahadur, which has happened 1 year after this, that is in 1729. See, the Marathas, they started invading Malwa, that is north of Narmada, which is considered to be very fertile province of the Mughal Empire. And they in fact started invading Malwa even during the time of Aurangzeb, though they were defeated and beaten back. But their expedition across Narmada towards north, it started long back when that Maratha War of Independence was going on against Aurangzeb. And slowly they were encroaching on the northern territory. And the Marathas, they now claimed that as they became militarily superior, that we will have the right to collect chauth from Malwa. Chauth is again, that is a tax. You know, this tax is paid to the Marathas by the ruler of the particular region, so that Marathas will not attack their territory. But it did not have any obligation on the part of the Marathas to protect that area until unless it is specifically mentioned in the treaty. So Marathas, they started claiming chauth. And you know, now at this time, when the Mughal Empire was on the decline after the death of Aurangzeb, there was an important person who rose to the position of the prominent courtier, that is Sawai Jai Singh. There was Jai Singh first, who was instrumental in forcing Chhatrapati Shivaji to sign the Treaty of Purandar in 1665. And his grandson was also named as Jai Singh, but he is known in history as Sawai Jai Singh, one who is step ahead than the earlier Jai Singh. So this person, Sawai Jai Singh, he was rising to the prominent place in the Mughal court. And at the same time, he was a person who was proud of his Hindu heritage. And he had an agreement with Peshwas and Marathas. Somehow he had a soft corner. And Peshwa and Jai Singh, they used to communicate. And it is with the help of the Marathas that the Jai Singh wanted to increase the prestige and power towards north. And now Peshwa, when he communicated with Jai Singh told him that you will not get the right to collect choth from Malwa until unless you show your military valor. And now the Marathas, they thought, okay, fine, now this is the time that we should show our Maratha valor and attack. Until unless you show your power, you are not going to get the right to collect choth. So, at the end of 1728, the Maratha forces, it got divided into the two parts. One was led by Chimaji Appa and another was led by Bajirao himself. So Chimaji Appa, he enters Malwa and he was assisted by Ranoji Sindhya, Mallara Holkar and Mehendale. These were the important Sardar. And on 29th November 1729, there was a person called Girdhar Bahadur who was Mughal subedar of Malwa, and he objected to the Maratha collecting choth. He obstructed them, and the battle was fought between this Girdhar Bahadur and his brother Daya Bahadur on the one side and Chimaji Appa and Marathas on the other side. And in this battle, Girdhar Bahadur and his brother, they both were killed. They fought bravely, but they were killed on 29 November 1729. And that is how once that subedar is killed, the Maratha, they occupied the significant portion of the Malwa, and slowly they went on encroaching, extending their area and border towards Gwalior and towards Agra. And this 1732, they made an arrangement where all the revenue from Malwa will be divided between the four power, Shinde and Holkar, they will get 22.5% of the revenue. Pawar will get 10%, and rest of the 22.5, that becomes 45%, and 10% that becomes 55%, and 45% of the revenue will go to Peshwa. That was an agreement that slowly reached after in 1732. But this killing and the battle of Amzera, that is the death of Girdhar Bahadur and his brother, was an important battle by which the Marathas could establish their stronghold in Malwa. So Shinde, they established themselves at Gwalior. Holkar, they established themselves at Indore, and Pawar, they established themselves at a place called Dhar. So this Malwa, it became an important kind of launching pad for further northerly expansion of the Maratha Empire. And now when this Battle of Amzera was happening and Chimaji Appa was in action against Girdhar Bahadur and Daya Bahadur, Bajirao, as I told you, the Maratha army was divided into the two parts. There was another army led by Bajirao. They entered in Gondwana, central India, the portion of central India. In fact, Nagpur was also considered as a part of Gondwana. And when he was at Gondwana under expedition, he received a letter from Chhatrasal, the king of Bundelkhand, who was 80 years old that time. And there is a background of this Chhatrasal. Chhatrasal's father, Champat Rai, he fought against Aurangzeb a very long-drawn war. He wanted to remain independent. Bundelkhand is the area comprising Jhansi and surrounding area now. And he fought against, Champat Rai fought against Aurangzeb to preserve their independence. Then Chhatrasal, his son, also fought against Aurangzeb. But then finally he surrenders. He was very young that time, 20 years old, and he enters the service of Jai Singh. Jai Singh first, who came to Maharashtra in 1664 and forced Shivaji to sign the Treaty of Purandar. So the Chhatrasal, he joins the Mughal contingent, and then he fought war under Mughal. But then he realized that he fought under Diler Khan, and then he realized that he is not being given the right credit. And when he came to Maharashtra, you know, he came to Maharashtra to fight as the Mughal commander. He was inspired by the work done by Shivaji, that Shivaji is trying to preserve the independence of the Marathas. And one day, along with his wife was also there, the young boy, young man of 20 years, he escapes from the Mughal camp and he goes straight to Shivaji. And there is a meeting between Shivaji and Chhatrasal. And he asked Shivaji that, I want to enter your service, I want to serve under you. And Shivaji, he gives him respect, he makes him to sit near him. And Shivaji tells him that, if you serve under me, all the credit of your valor and your bravery will come to me, that you are serving the Maratha cause. Why not to go back to Bundelkhand, your own motherland, and try to liberate it from the clutches of the Mughal? And that will be a greater work to do. And Chhatrasal, inspired by Shivaji's word, he goes back. He hardly had any army, very few people, but he goes around. He tries to talk to the different kings of Bundelkhand who surrendered to the Mughals. And he tries to form a league against the Mughal. Some people, they support him. Some people oppose him. But then he continues to fight against the Mughal for a very long period. But, you know, the odds were against him. The Mughal had a very huge army. But he still maintained his stronghold. But now, Muhammad Khan Bangash, the Afghan Pathan, very strict, very, 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 very brave. And he had a very well organized army. He becomes the Mughal governor of Allahabad. Now, as the area of Bundelkhand was coming under the jurisdiction of Mughal governor of Allahabad, this Ahmad Khan Bangash, he puts a lot of pressure. He sends his army, and a lot of wars were fought between Chhatrasal on the one side and the Mughal commander, that is Ahmad Khan Bangash, on the other side. As the Mughal army was much more superior, Chhatrasal was defeated at a number of places. And finally, Chhatrasal surrenders. The fort of Jaitpur, which was the very important and the very strong fort of Bundela king, it was surrendered and it was occupied by Bangash. But, you know, Chhatrasal was not willing to take this surrender. He was not willing to digest this surrender and defeat. He looked at Bajirao Peshwa as a person who can help him in his distressed position. And he wrote a long letter to Bajirao Peshwa. Now, some people believe that, you know, there are very beautiful words in that letter. You know, there is a mythological story in the Hindu scriptures in which the king of elephant, his feet, when he went to have water in the lake, his feet was caught by a crocodile, and he was very distressed now because, you know, in water the crocodiles are very strong, and the crocodile started pulling him in the water. The Gajaraj, the king of elephant, was very, very strong on the land, but in water it was crocodile which was becoming stronger, and it was gaining strength. It was pulling this king of elephant in the water so that he can kill him and eat him. Finally, the elephant in distress, he saw there is a lotus. And he picks up the lotus with his trunk and offers it to God Vishnu. You know, that is a mythological story. God's Vishnu, and remember God Vishnu. And he, according to that mythological story, God Vishnu descends from his place, Vaikuntha, and you know, on his vahana, on his vehicle, that is Garuda, the giant bird, giant mythological bird, and he kills the crocodile. And the elephant, the king elephant, is liberated. So, you know, he refers to that mythological story and says in a Bundeli word, Jo gat Gajendra ki wo gat hui hai aaj, baji laaj Bundeli ki baji rakho laaj. You know, words might be here and there, but the meaning that he wanted to communicate is that as the king of elephant was caught by that crocodile and he was pulled in the lake, my condition is also same now. I am being caught by this Muhammad Khan Bangash, and I am being pulled under the lake. You have to save my, you have to save me, you have to save my prestige. And Bajirao was at Gadamandala in the southern Middle India. Gadamandala is in Madhya Pradesh now. And he got this letter, and he wrote immediately to his brother Chimaji Appaiah that you finish your war against Giridhar Bahadur and rush to the help of Chhatrasal, and I am rushing from Gadamandala. Now, you know, Muhammad Khan Bangash, he did not count that the Marathas, even though Chhatrasali is trying to communicate with them, the Maratha army, which is far away, Gadha Mandala, will be able to rush with such a rapid speed. But that was one of the important advantage with Bajirao and the Maratha army under Bajirao. Marathas later on lost that advantage. Marathas army, they did not carry women with them, first thing. They were not having a burden of heavy artillery. They used to travel very light. And for two horse riders, there used to be one additional horse. So, you know, two people, three horses. So that one horse can travel without any without anybody mounting the horse. And that horse will be comparatively fresh. So, and the Marathas, they develop a kind of habit of sleeping on the back of the horse, you know. So the horse are traveling, some people will be awake, guide the moment, and some people will just sleep when the horses are moving. So they could travel at a very rapid speed without taking rest in the night. And that is what Bajirao has done during this time. From Gadha Mandala, that is in Madhya Pradesh now, he rushes to the help of Chhatrasal in Bundelkhand very quickly. And meanwhile, Chhatrasal, who was captured and put in the prison by Muhammad Khan Bangash, Chhatrasal, he managed to free himself from that captivity. Somehow he kills the guard, bribes some of them, and he rushes. He moves out of the captivity, and Bajirao Peshwa and Chhatrasal, they meet at one place. And the Bundela army, whatever they could gather now, Bundela and Maratha army under Peshwa, they attack Muhammad Khan Bangash. Muhammad Khan Bangash was defeated, and then he took shelter in the fort of Jaipur, the fort that he captured from the Bundela king themselves. And when he was surrounded in the fort of Jaipur, his son, who was at Delhi, he requested the emperor to send help to my father. He is surrounded. Muhammad Khan Bangash appealed to the emperor, but you know, the Mughal court was divided. There was a lot of internal enmity among the nobility, and the emperor himself was not very active. But his son, Muhammad Khan Bangash's son Qayyam Khan, you know, it is believed that even his wife, Muhammad Khan Bangash's wife, she appealed to her Afghan, you know, other Sardar brother, that one of your Afghan brother is surrounded, about to lose his life. So you have to help him. And his son, in fact, Qayyam Khan, he gathers certain army, gathers certain supply. You know, Muhammad Khan Bangash was reduced to the very, very dire state. He was not getting food. And that was one of the important tactics that the Marathas has used. Instead of directly attacking the enemy, which would lead to the loss on the both sides, they will surround, cut the supply, strive the enemy, even cut the water supply, strive the enemy and compel him to surrender, so that the loss is less and the gain is more. Well, now this Qayyam Khan, he gathers certain army, he gathers certain supply, and he rushes to Jaipur to help his father. But the Marathas were good. They followed very good military tactics under Bajirao. Bajirao took care that he is not going and joining with his father. So another Maratha army, they stopped him and they defeated him, and Qayyam Khan has to run away to save his life. And Bangash, he was now helpless. He knew that he cannot expect anything from the emperor. And Bangash, he surrendered. And then he promises to Bajirao that I will not hereafter enter Bundelkhand. He goes back to the, you know, he goes away from Bundelkhand. And this Muhammad Khan Bangash, later on, though he continued to fight Marathas, he maintained good relation with Bajirao. Later on, when Bajirao's mother went for the pilgrimage to Northern India, Muhammad Khan Bangash ensured that she travels safely through his territory. And he called her that, "You are like my own mother." Well, history throws many very, very, very interesting episodes. You are enemy on the battlefield, but you respect the mother of your enemy. That was a great chivalrous act on the part of Muhammad Khan Bangash. We should accept it. Well, now, as Chhatrasal's kingdom was now saved by Bajirao saved his prestige at the right time, rush with a very high speed from Gadha Mandala to Bundelkhand. Chhatrasal was very, very happy and very pleased with the act of Bajirao. He was a war veteran for number of war, more than 80 years old now. He had two sons, and then he considered Bajirao as his third son. And he made that, after my death, my kingdom will be divided into three parts. The two part will go to my two sons, and one third of the part will go to Bajirao, which Bajirao got it later on after his death. And here it is believed that, Chhatrasal, the king used to have a number of wives. And one of the wife of Chhatrasal was Muslim lady, and a daughter was born to that Muslim lady, Mastani, who was exceptionally beautiful and exceptionally good dancer and singer. And this lady, this girl, Mastani, she was here married to Bajirao. But, this is a bit controversial. Some people say that she was she was daughter of Chhatrasal, and some people don't agree with this. It's pretty difficult to reach to any conclusion as of now for me. But generally, it is accepted that it is after this Bajirao's help to Chhatrasal that Mastani was married to Bajirao, and he took her with him to Pune. And though that was the love of his life, but that Mastani episode has created a lot of trouble in his personal life, because she, being a daughter of a Muslim lady, was not accepted in the Orthodox Brahmin family of Peshwa. And next thing is that Bajirao became too infatuated with Mastani, and he used to spend a lot of time with her, ignoring his own family. And he used to also drink and eat meat, which is forbidden for the in the Orthodox tradition for the Brahmin, and that created a lot of havoc in his personal life. So we are not, I don't want to digress too much, I don't want to go into the detail, but this is a very interesting episode. You can see the movie Bajirao Mastani. Of course, movie is not a very true and right presentation of the historical fact, but you, if you are curious, you can read the books on Mastani. Well, now, Mamad Khan Bangash was defeated at Jaipur. He goes back. Bajirao comes back in 1929, but in 1730, now Mamad Khan Bangash, who was the Subedar of Allahabad, now he was appointed as the Subedar of Malwa in 1730. When he was appointed as a Subedar in 1730, before that in Malwa, after that battle of Amjhera and the death of Giridhar Bahadur and Daya Bahadur, the Marathas had occupied significant portion of Malwa, that is Indore, Gwalior, Dhar. I told you about that. But when Bangash was appointed as Subedar of Malwa, Bajirao was occupied with his conflict with Dabhade. And about that conflict, we will discuss later on. I'll tell you about the conflict with Dabhade, who was Dabhade and what was that conflict all about. But, when Bangash came to take the charge of Malwa with the intention to drive the Marathas away from Malwa, and as Bajirao was occupied with his problem with Dabhade, Bangash, he attacks Maratha, whatever the Maratha forces were there in Malwa. And the Peshwa could not send a reinforcement from Pune to support his Maratha Sardars like Holkar and Sindhya. And in January, February 1731, Holkar was defeated by Mamad Khan Bangash in Malwa. And the Marathas were attacked at different places by this Mughal army of Bangash, and they were forced to leave Ujjain, Andhar and Mandu. And the forts that were constructed by the Marathas to the north of Narbada, they were also captured by Bangash. But here he committed one mistake. When Bangash was driving the Marathas away from Malwa, he had meeting with Nizam. Nizam was considered as a rebel from the perspective of the emperor. The Mughal emperor considered that Nizam has rebelled against him, as he formed his own independent principality, independent kingdom in the south. Though Nizam never, technically speaking, he always considered himself as the servant of the Mughal emperor, but virtually he used to rule as an independent ruler. But the meeting between Bangash and Nizam, their intention was to form a coalition with Dabhade against Peshwa. But this meeting between Bangash and Nizam, it upset the Mughal emperor. Mughal emperor thought that Nizam, very strong, very capable diplomatically and war veteran, he fought a number of war. As he is against me, probably if Bangash joins hands against me with Nizam, the coalition against me will be very stronger. And he was quite upset. That has finally it proved a little bad for Muhammad Khan Bangush. Now he did not get any help from the court. He did not get any help from the Mughal court. And as the emperor became suspicious about Muhammad Khan Bangush, and when in October 1731 Marathas they crossed Narmada and entered Malwa once again. That was the usual time when Marathas went on expedition. That is after Dashera. Dashera is a festival which usually takes place in the month of October, and after Dashera Marathas used to start their expedition because after that there is no rain, generally speaking. So Maratha enters Narmada, that is Malwa, once again in 1731, and Muhammad Khan Bangush, with his limited forces, was not in a position to stop the Marathas. So he requests help from the Delhi Darbar, from the Mughal. He did not get help, but on the other hand, he was removed from the subedarship of Malwa, and in his place, Savai Jai Singh was appointed in 1732 as the subedar of Malwa. And Savai Jai Singh, as we have already referred to, was friendly towards Marathas. So that was the situation in Malwa. So we have seen these two, three important episodes, how Bangush was defeated at Jaitpur. But later on, he comes back as the subedar of Malwa. He defeats the Marathas at a number of places, and the Marathas, they loses the ground. Whatever gain they have got in 1729, it was lost, but then it was regained again after 1732, that we will be seeing subsequently. But as I have already referred to the conflict between Bajirao and Dabade, and it was to support Dabade that probably Nizam and Muhammad Khan Bangush came together. So let us come refer to the Dabade episode now. Well, I hope things are clear now. It's a bit complicated. Lot of stuff, lot of material is there. But I think if you go through notes and may have to listen to the lecture once again. But you know, the expedition and expansion always have a lot of complication because a lot of things are happening simultaneously. We have seen that Chimaji Appa is fighting at one place at Amzera, and at the same time Bajirao is rushing to the help of Chhatrasal, and we need to take this both thing into consideration, because here we are discussing Maratha expansion towards north, which involves definitely Malwa expansion. Well, so in the conflict between Bajirao and Dabade, the important battle that took place, that is the Battle of Davoi in April 1731. And what was the background why this conflict took place initially? Let us go into that. You know, in 1717, Khanderao Dabade was appointed as Senapati by Chhatrapati Shahu. And but you know, Khanderao Dabade, though quite capable person, he was growing very old. And Bajirao, who became Peshwa in 1720, was full of energy, full of ambitious, and he had a magnetic personality. So people started gathering around him, and he was proving himself on the battlefield one after another. So he was doing the work of Senapati. Fighting the war is in fact the important work of Senapati, to lead the army, and that was done by Peshwa now. So Khanderao, he felt a bit sidelined, and but he could not do anything. He was quite of an old age and ailing, and the power passed into the hand of his wife and his son Trimbak Rao. And Khanderao, he dies in 1729, almost at the same time when Bajirao was expanding Maratha empire in Malwa. And his son Trimbak Rao now becomes Senapati. And as Khanderao himself was quite jealous of Bajirao, his son was also equally jealous. Khanderao, this Trimbak Rao and Bajirao, they could never get along very, very well. And he opposed Bajirao's policy in the court itself. At the same time, he considered that Gujarat is his own area of expansion. And as the Peshwa is also encroaching in Gujarat, trying to collect Chauth and Sar Deshmukhi, that was also not liked by Dabade, Trimbak Rao Dabade, and it became an important point of disagreement between these two. And Shahu, he could not resolve the conflict between these two, Trimbak Rao and Peshwa. And Trimbak Rao was so upset with the growth of Bajirao as well as Shahu's support to Bajirao, that he even opened communication with Nizam, the enemy of Marathas. And Bajirao, the ambitions of these two people, they clash. And Bajirao, he was trying to turn some supporter of Dabade towards him. And this was also not liked by Dabare. It angered him further, and he formed a secret alliance with Nizam. And Nizam, he was, you know, after his defeat by Bajirao in 1728, he was looking for an opportunity to reduce the power of Bajirao in the Maratha kingdom, and if possibly to reduce the power of Shahu as well. So he was willing to join hands with anybody who is willing to conspire against Bajirao in the Maratha kingdom. And Trimpakrao Dabade and Nizam, they open communication. And there were some other Maratha Sardar who were quite dissatisfied with the growth of Bajirao Peshwa, dissatisfied with his influence in the court. Because Bajirao, though on expedition, he used to always keep his representative in the court of Sataya. In fact, later on, his son, Nana Saheb, who later on became Peshwa, was his representative in the court. Earlier, his brother, Chimaji Appa, who also fought in numerous war, Chimaji Appa stayed at Satara as his representative and ensured that the Peshwa's influence remained prominent in the court. Peshwa is not being, you know, somebody should not misguide the Maratha king, Shahu. So there were numerous enemies of Bajirao Peshwa, like Udaji Pawar and his brother Anandrao, Pilaji Gaikwad, Chimnaji Damodar. So those were the important Maratha Sardar. They joined hands against Bajirao with Trimbak Rao, and Trimbak Rao, he joined hands with Nizam. So this came as a big threat. When Bajirao made Shahu aware of this conspiracy, Shahu was, you know, alarmed. Earlier he thought that this is just a conflict within the kingdom. I'll resolve it. Dabade and Bajirao, I'll call them together and I will try to resolve. But when Dabade had joined hands with Nizam along with some Maratha Sardar, and when Bajirao got a hint of it, he made Shahu aware that this is a very important threat to you. And now Shahu started looking at Bajirao as a person who could resolve the issue. Before that, Shahu sent number of letters to Trimbak Rao Dabade that you come to Satara, let us sit and let us resolve the issue. But Trimbak Rao did not respond and did not go to Satara. And now Shahu finally ordered Bajirao, you go to Baroda, go to Gujarat and bring Dabade to me. Now this was a very, very, very tricky issue, because Bajirao was given a very, very important responsibility, and Shahu was hopeful that if Bajirao can bring Dabade to Satara, I'll be able to resolve the issue. And in October 1730, Bajirao and Chimaji Appa, they started with their forces towards Gujarat from Pune. And they got the information about all that conspiracy that was happening between Dabade and Nizam. And at the same time, the Mughal emperor, they appointed Mumad Khan Bangash in Malwa, that we have already referred to. Mumad Khan Bangash becomes the governor of Malwa, and Abhay Singh was appointed as the governor of Gujarat. And they both were given strict instruction to stop the activities of Marathas. Marathas should not be able to collect chauth from Malwa and Gujarat. And now Mamad Khan Mangash meeting, I have already referred to. Mamad Khan Mangash, he had meeting with Nizam. He came from Ujjain, and then they agreed to support Dabade. And Nizam also, at the end of 1730, he start from Aurangabad to join Dabade against Bajirao. Nizam and Mangash, they met at Akbarpur. That was a town on the border of the two provinces, you know. Then Bangash retires to Ujjain and Nizam goes to Gujarat. But as the emperor looked at suspicious, he did not support Mamad Khan Bangash. And as a result, this coalition did not become very strong against Bajirao. This has weakened Dabade's position. So by the time when all this thing was happening, Bajirao and Chimaji Appa, they entered Gujarat. They started chasing Dabade. And Mallarrao Holkar was the important Maratha commander of Bajirao. He was stationed on the bank of Narmada to keep a strict watch on the activities of Nizam and Bangash, so that Nizam's army and Bangash's army did not join Dabade. And via Nashik, Surat and Bharuj, Bajirao, he came very closer to Baroda, that is capital of Gujarat, where you know the Maratha, that is Dabade, used to stay. And when he got information that Nizam is coming to the help of Dabade and probably Bangash would also come, he had meeting with Abhay Singh at Ahmedabad, the provincial capital of Mughal province of Gujarat was Ahmedabad, where Abhay Singh used to, you know, the governor Abhay Singh was there, and Bajirao and Abhay Singh, they reached an agreement. Abhay Singh agreed to pay 13 lakh rupees per year to Bajirao, provided that he should not, he should prevent other Maratha Sardar from attacking Gujarat. And the very important Sardar who was attacking that Gujarat province was, of course, Pilaji Gaikwad and Dabades. So as Pilaji Gaikwad, you know, he was also unhappy with the Bajirao's activity. He also joined hands with Dabade, and at Dabai, this Dabade and Gaikwad forces, they came together. That was around 40,000 strong force. And Bajirao, from his side, he repeatedly sent message to Dabade that you should go and meet Shahu at Satara. But you know, Dabade was not listening. And when Bajirao got the information that this 40,000 strong forces, they have gathered together to attack Bajirao, he had less forces, 25,000. Bajirao, you know, he was expert in the shock tactics. So before these forces can rally together and attack Peshwa, Bajirao attacks Dabade first. And he suddenly attacked Dabade. Dabade, he fought very bravely. But you know, he was sitting on the elephant, and suddenly a bullet hits
him. Sir, you're not audible.
I'm not audible.